you're all going to get involved in assisted living one way or the other. What I mean by that is you're either going to own the real estate or operate the business or both, or you or a family member is going to be in assisted living, lying in a bed, writing a check to somebody else to take care of.
Welcome to the Rental Property Owner and Real Estate Investor Podcast, brought to you by the Rental Property Owner Association, providing benefits and services to real estate investors and rental property owners for over 48 years. With your host, Brian Hamrick from Hamrick Investment Group.
This episode is sponsored by Green Property Management, managing everything from single-family homes to apartment complexes in the West Michigan area. Find out more at greenpropertymgt.com. And RCB & Associates, helping real estate investors and small business owners navigate the complex world of health insurance and Medicare benefits at rcbassociatesllc.com. Before we get started, I want to thank all of you for listening to this show. And I especially want to thank you for listening to this current conversation that I'm about to have with Gene Guarino on residential assisted living. I actually recorded this over the summer, and I would have released it months ago. But then we booked Gene to be one of our featured speakers at the upcoming Michigan Landlord and Real Estate Investor Free Conference and Expo of 2019. This is happening February 21st through 23rd of 2019, right here in Grand Rapids, Michigan. Let me give you a brief rundown on some of the incredible topics and speakers that you'll be exposed to when you come to this conference. We have Beth Carson talking about short-term and vacation rental investing, Scott Myers talking about self-storage investing, Marco Kozlowski, who's going to be talking about mobile home investing, Alan Cowgill, who talks about private money and lending, of course, Gene Guarino talking about senior citizen housing, Cameron Gaskill, who's going to be talking about rehabbing and flipping for profit. We have Sue Nelson, who's going to be talking about multifamily and apartment investing. And one of our returning featured speakers, who everybody loves, Jeffrey Taylor, aka Mr. Landlord. He's going to be talking about increasing your rental cash flow by the thousands. We're also going to have a lot of great panels with Q&A, including panels on the new marijuana law that just passed here in Michigan, buying and selling notes. And we're also going to have a special live panel with our local celebrities, Jeremy Cole and Ramon Huerta, who are the stars of the new HGTV show From Gritty to Pretty. So this is going to be an incredible event. Once again, it's free, February 21st through 23rd of 2019, right here in Grand Rapids, Michigan. You can register for free by going to rpoaonline.org. So let's get into our conversation with Gene. Hello and welcome to episode 148. Sooner or later, every one of us will be faced with the challenges that today's guest is going to be addressing. And I'm talking about our aging population and the increasing need to provide care and housing for them. Gene Guarino is a CFP, Certified Financial Planner, and he's the founder of the Residential Assisted Living Academy, and he's regarded as the expert in the residential senior housing space. Today, Gene is going to share how you can participate in this opportunity as a real estate investor, business owner, or simply a passive investor in this fast-growing niche. Gene, thanks so much for being on the show.
Thank you for having me.
Tell us a little bit about yourself. What's your background with real estate investing, and how did you get into this niche of senior housing?
Well, my story goes all the way back to when I was a teenager. I was a professional musician, music school, recording studio, small record label, and we were tenants with a landlord who wasn't very good. And that was way back when I was 16, 17, 18 years old. And after 2 years of being there, we said, we're either going to shut this business down or we have to get a new place. And we looked up the street, saw a for sale sign, and that was the beginning of my real estate career. So I was 18 years old, bought a house with no money down, did fix and flip, buy and hold, did our first commercial at 25. And now flash forward here all these years later, and I'm an older guy now, 57. The only thing that I do now is what's called residential assisted living, single family homes and converting them into the assisted living. Huge cash flow and a great way to help other people.
Tell us how you got started in that. When did that light bulb go off?
It was about 15 years ago that I heard somebody from the front of a room with hundreds of people. They were talking about all kinds of things, but he shared about assisted living. And he said, this is going to be the place to be. This is where everything is going in our demographics. And I was very excited, and I went up to the front of the room, pulled on his sleeve and said, "Tell me more." And he said, "Well, I can't. I don't actually do it. I'm just telling you, you should do it." So I was disappointed, couldn't find anybody who was willing to show me how to do it. So my interest kind of waned, real life comes into play. And it wasn't until years later that my mom started to need help. And that was about 5-6 years ago. And when she started to need help, it becomes very real. It's no longer just a real estate play or a money-making play, it's mom. And when we went to look for a solution for her, a place to bring her, everything we found was not what we were looking for. It was a big box facility. You could smell the neglect as soon as you walked through the front door. And mom lived in a home and she wanted to be in her own home, but she needed help. So at that point, I vowed to create a solution, and that's where Residential Assisted Living Academy was born.
What are the demographics like right now? What are the numbers of people who are going into this phase of their life where they're going to require this type of housing?
There are, as we all know the stats with baby boomers, 77 million baby boomers. That means an average of 10,000 people a day are turning 65. More importantly, 4,000 a day are turning 85. So somebody moves into assisted living is not a 65-year-old. They're off playing golf and tennis and pickleball and traveling. But an 85-year-old, by that point in life, a lot of people do need help with what we call activities of daily living. So they could be at home, and that's where they'd like to be, but they may need some help. And the more help they need, eventually they're going to need some kind of assistance. So the demographics with 4,000 a day turning 85, let me just run the numbers for you. That's 120,000 new 85-year-olds every single month, 1.4 million every single year. If you add up all of the beds available in America today for assisted living, it's about 1.4 million beds. So the demand for what we do, provide housing and care for these seniors, is incredible today, and it's just going to get better and better and better. The front edge of the baby boomers, they're only 71 years old, so they're not in assisted living today. Their parents are, but they know it's coming. They know that they need to prepare. So 10 or 15 years from now, when they start to enter assisted living facilities, the need will go off the chart.
And with your mother, what solution did you find for her, and how did that lead to your business model?
Well, I'm fortunate. I've got six brothers and sisters, seven of us all together. And even though I live thousands of miles away from mom in upstate New York, two of my sisters were able to spend more time with mom and take care of her as best they could. Once it got beyond that, since we couldn't find an acceptable solution, we hired people to come into the house. And the average for that is $23 an hour. So imagine paying $23 an hour for 8 or 10 hours a day. That gets expensive over the course of a month. So we had the in-home caregivers, and mom ended up, she passed away inside at my sister's home with the caregivers that were there. But along the way, because I was thousands of miles away in Arizona, created the first residential assisted living home for myself, and then the next and the next, and been teaching everybody how to do it since then.
What exactly are you teaching? I mean, what you created the first residential assisted living home. How many beds did you have, and what did it look like?
Yeah, and I want to be clear, I didn't necessarily invent it, but I have created the system for others to be able to replicate it from a business perspective. There were people and are people that do this as kind of what I call a mom and pop. They live in the house. Their kids have moved away. They've got some extra bedrooms. They have seniors come in, charge them $4,000 or $5,000 a month. They make some extra food, do some extra laundry. It's a live-in mom-and-pop model. That's not what I do. What I do is I find the right home in the right location. So it's a real estate play on one side, and I know that's what your listeners are mostly interested in. It's a real estate play on one side, and I'll talk a lot more about that. On the other side is the business, the aspect of taking care of those seniors. And a typical home in America today, there's different limits or rules and regulations of what you can do and how you do it. But a typical home would have 10 residents in it. So it might be two people in a bedroom, five bedrooms. Most homes only have three or four bedrooms, so you might convert some space inside. Two people living in one bedroom. It could be private rooms, and that's what I prefer. That's what the residents would prefer in most cases as well. So those people who are living there, if there's 10 of them, the average today is $3,750 per month for a senior to live in an assisted living facility or a home. So that's an average home. And if you were to go to the average place, you would not be satisfied with leaving mom there. you would want above average. So let's just even call it $4,000 per person times 10 residents is $40,000 a month in gross revenue. Now, there are expenses, but the bottom line is we're going to net somewhere between 25 and 30% of that gross income will come to the bottom line in profit.
How many beds are we talking about then? It sounds like you're kind of focusing on a 10-bed facility.
Yeah, it depends on the state. Some states say 6 beds for senior assisted living in a residential setting. Some say 8. The state of Texas is 16 in what's called a small facility. Some states, many of them, it's unlimited. It just needs to be safe for seniors, and that's a whole nother conversation what that means. I'm in Arizona, so the limit in Arizona, Nevada is 10. So 10 is a good even middle-of-the-road number.
If you are thinking of leaving your W-2 job and becoming a full-time real estate investor, one of the greatest costs you must consider is healthcare for you and your family. When I made this transition 5 years ago, I found the whole healthcare insurance process to be confusing and frustrating. That's why I'm glad I met Chad Creasy at RCB & Associates. Chad is a professional health insurance agent who helps real estate investors and small business owners understand and choose their best healthcare options. And best of all, his services are covered by the insurance company and won't cost you a dime. If you're expecting a change in your healthcare insurance coverage for any reason, then you owe it to yourself to contact Chad Creasy at rcbassociatesllc.com. The difference between this residential model with 10 beds or so and the larger type facilities where you might have 100 beds, why is it you focus on the smaller facilities?
There's a couple of reasons. One is just from the what you're providing for that senior, it's very different. In a home like ours with 10 residents, we'll probably have 2 caregivers, direct caregivers during the day and 1 at night. It is a home, not home-like. So it's an actual home, and the caregiver ratio might be 5 or 6 to 1 when it comes to the residents. In a big box facility, it's like a hotel, like an apartment building. It's a big, impersonal place. In addition to that, the caregiver staff, direct caregiver staff, might be 15 to 1, 20 to 1. At night, it could be 50 to 1. Perfectly legal, and that's the way they operate. In a big facility, they'll also have a lot of staff that is the layers of hierarchy in management. So you have a manager, an executive director, an assistant manager, all the way down to the caregiver. So even though the caregiver is the most important part, there's a lot of layers of bureaucracy and corporate control above that that get expensive and absorb a lot of the money. So even though we may charge the same rate, I believe we do a better job with a better product in a home, not home-like.
You're getting a better service for the money.
Yeah, that's what I was looking for mom. It wasn't as much how nice is the house or how nice is this big, huge facility. It's who are the caregivers? Do they love mom? Is it the same caregivers each day, or is it some new shift every 8 hours? And that's really what it comes down to. When somebody's looking for a place to take care of mom, they're trusting this location to take care of their loved one. It's not, is the crown molding beautiful or is the marble floor perfect? It's not that. Now, I do want it to be very nice, and we do upscale assisted living in a residential setting, but it's really about the care and the quality of that care. The other big thing from a pricing standpoint, if anybody's listening and you're looking potentially for a home for a parent or a grandparent, is when you go to a big box facility, they'll quote you a rate, and it'll be what's called the base rate. And they may say, well, it's $3,000 for the base rate. And you're like, well, that's cheaper than Gene's. He said it's $5,000. Well, the base rate. Then they're going to ask you questions. Would mom like to eat? Well, of course she would. Well, how often? Well, 3 times a day. Oh, you've got the, executive meal plan. Does mom take medication? Yes. Well, how many? I don't know. 5, 6. Oh, that's level C, medication management. Before you know it, the $3,000 base rate is $2,000-$4,000 higher than what you thought it was after you add in all the things that mom actually needs. Versus you come to our home, it's one price, it's all inclusive. There's nothing extra that's added for mom and dad's care.
Any other tips for people who are searching for a place like this?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, location is important. Price is important. But go there unannounced. You're probably going to go there the first time with an appointment, and they're ready for you, right? And then go back and visit. Go on an evening. Go on a weekend. See if you can just visit without an appointment, one. when you go there, they're not prepared for you for the big tour. So see, how do they respond? How do they react? Did it look the same as it did when you were there when they were expecting you? Some places, big or small, they don't allow visitors to just stop in. You have to make an appointment. Some even say 24 hours in advance, which just makes you think, what are you hiding? You know, and so go there unexpected. At some point, once you're getting down to that final decision, it's either this place or this place, go and see it. Talk to the caregivers and get to know them a little bit, because those are the ones that are taking care of mom and dad. It's not the marketing director or the landscaper or the chef. It's that caregiver who's providing care. Do they seem like a loving individual? Or are they there punching a clock and they're going to go pick up their night job at Walmart's later on?
I'd like to take a moment to tell you about Green Property Management. Not only do they manage everything from single-family homes to apartment complexes in the West Michigan area, they also manage my entire portfolio. So I can tell you from personal experience that their unique flat fee management style is worth a closer look. If you feel that your property isn't operating to its fullest potential, then Green Property Management can help you take a holistic approach that will save you money, eliminate your headaches, and increase your net income. And if you're a property manager interested in applying Green Property Management's model, give them a call at 1-866-95-GREEN or visit them on the web at greenpropertymgt.com. Your model seems to be about residential assisted senior housing as opposed to just residential senior housing. Can you talk about the difference there? Because,
sure.
Because I know from an investment standpoint, I've looked at both types, and I want to be clear on exactly what it is you're focused on.
You got it. And when I talk about residential assisted living, there are two parts, and that's the best way to look at it. There's the real estate on one side and the business on the other. So let's just talk real estate first. When you talk about the Golden Girls model, and that's what we teach as well, that's taking a single family home, and instead of doing, let's say, student housing or Airbnb, where you're renting it out short term, or student housing, where it's by the bedroom to a student who's there for 9-10 months, think Golden Girls. Four bedrooms leased out to a senior where you're not providing care, but they now have a place where they can live in community with three or four other adults, peers their own age. So you're taking care of the utilities and the house upkeep and so on. So the model there, instead of leasing the house for $2,000 a month to a family with two kids and a dog that moves after a year or two, you're going to lease it by the bedroom to those seniors. They're going to be there for years and years and years, and you might lease it per bedroom for $1,000. So four bedrooms, $1,000. You're going to take care of the utilities and upkeep, call that $500 a month, but now you're bringing in $3,500 a month versus $2,000 a month with long-term tenants. So the Golden Girls model would look like that. What we do is we take it a step further. The assisted living, the residential assisted living, take that single family home, and the location is critically important, that single family home in the middle of a nice upscale neighborhood, and those people are not renting the house. They're not tenants. Inside the home, there are, let's say, 10 seniors there, more women than men, and let's say they have private rooms and some shared rooms. They're paying $4,000 or $5,000 a month to be a resident in the home. So they're not tenants, and that's an important distinction. The person who's living in the home, their activities of daily living are being taken care of by the business, the operator of. So just from a pure real estate play, you could lease the home to an operator of the residential assisted living. They do all the heavy lifting of the business. They provide the caregivers and all of that. You're just leasing the home to them. Why would you potentially want to do that? Well, you could charge anything you want for rent. At the end of the month, they're going to end up with $10,000 or $12,000 or $15,000 in profit. So you potentially could charge them twice, double the market rent. They're going to be a long-term tenant. They're going to want a five-year lease, not a one-year lease. So you have a long-term tenant. In addition to that, they want to make sure the home looks good from the outside, curb appeal, and is taken care of on the inside because they're providing the services for the seniors. So you're going to have a tenant that maintains the home. So a long-term, low-impact tenant at up to twice the market rent would be your motivation to want to lease the home to that operator.
Let's focus on that right there, just owning the home and leasing it out to an operator. For investors who might have a home that would be appropriate or would be interested in purchasing a home that they could lease out, what exactly do you need to look for in that property?
Well, more importantly than the property, Brian, and I want to make sure everybody hears this, in this case, in this very specific model of seniors and housing, I'm going to highly recommend that you find the tenant for the residential assisted living. Find that business owner, that tenant, before you pick the house. If you know who that is you're going to lease it to for 5 years at twice the fair market rent, ask them the question, where do you want the house? You tell me where you want that house. The where the house is much more important than the house. We could scrape the house away and build it brand new. The tenant and their location is critically important. So find the tenant first. Now, if I were looking at the house myself, what I'm looking for, it's better to have a single level bungalow, that type of home versus two or three story. You definitely can do it with a two and three story home. Frankly, most of the country, that is what the inventory is for real estate. But seniors, if they have any mobility issues, getting up a flight of stairs can be difficult. Doesn't mean they can't. My grandmother went up the stairs till she was 100 years old, till they finally brought her bed downstairs so she didn't have to. So single level is better than multi-level. More bathrooms is better than less. Minimum, you're going to need two bathrooms, but if you had three or four, it's better. If you can add bathrooms or make one big bathroom into two smaller ones, that's better as well. So a bigger home is better. The state may require a certain number, but I'll give you our rule of thumb. We have all kinds of benchmarks, rules of thumbs, do's and don'ts, and when we teach somebody how to do this. But one is a very comfortable residential assisted living home would have, let's say, 300 square feet of living space per resident. So if you have a 3,000 square foot home, you can have 10 or 12 residents very comfortably. The state would require half that space. You could have a 1,500 square foot home and have 10 residents living in it. And there's homes just like that all over the country with waiting lists and people banging down their doors to get in. I don't want to operate that way. We do a nicer home in a nicer area, bigger space, more amenities and a higher quality. And then we can charge more for that, of course, as well.
And what are some of the considerations with the city, the state, you know, as far as getting the permission to actually do this?
Great news is that the Fair Housing Act works in our favor. For most landlords and tenants, it's all about the tenant and it's bad for the landlord. Since we're not doing a rental, we're not leasing it to mom or dad or the grandma, you're using this home for the residential assisted living, that's one of those protected classes with inside the Fair Housing Code. You cannot discriminate based on age and so on. So for instance, you may have a community that says you can only have four unrelated adults living in a home. Well, that doesn't apply to senior housing. There are rules and regulations in each state. So the first thing is to know what those are, whether it's a limit of 10 or 16 or 8 or whatever it may be. But then once you pick the location, I'm going to do it not just in this state, but in this city, in this neighborhood. Then you want to find out the local zoning. What is it that I can or can't do in that local area? You can go to the zoning board and find out. One of the key things to know for those of you listening and getting interested in this is what is it called? Because if you call it the wrong thing, if you go to zoning and say, I want to open up an assisted living facility in the middle of the neighborhood, they're probably going to say, no, you can't do that. And you're thinking, well, hold it. I heard this guy on the podcast. He said I could. No, assisted living facility is equivalent to saying I want to open a gas station in the middle of the neighborhood. It may be called a personal care home. That's what it's called in Georgia. It may be called an assisted living home. That's what it's called in Arizona. It may be called an RCFE. That's what it's called in California. So each location has its own name. So you need to know what it's called first. Ask the zoning, this is the name. What can I do? Where can I do it? They'll let you know what the process is. Some locations, it's literally fill in one piece of paper, give them a $50 check, you're approved. Other locations, you need to go through a process, which could be a 30-day process or a six-month process, depending on the locations, the rules, and regulations.
What about from the fire marshal's perspective? If you have that many, let's say you have 10 people in the house, do you then have to worry about putting sprinklers in or any other type of infrastructure?
Yeah, the fire and safety code is important. So we want to make sure that, again, whatever's required in your area. So most places will require you to go to the fire chief, basically, and make application. They're going to come to the home, do an inspection. And they've either told you in advance or I've trained you what to do. or they're going to tell you right then, you need to have this and this and this. So more than likely, you're going to be required to have smoke detectors that are all wired together in one system, not standalone in each single bedroom. So hardwired, wired together smoke detectors. If you're not required to have fire suppression or sprinklers, I'm going to suggest you do it anyway. If I'm going to be taking care of seniors in a home, I want them safe if there's a fire. So the fire suppression may or may not be required, but if it isn't, still consider doing it. That fire suppression sprinklers in a home is not common in the average home, but in a residential assisted living, it is something that is certainly good to have, probably required. I'm going to say you should do it anyway. Fire extinguishers, there needs to be a certain number of those in certain locations. And then the rest of it, what happens after that, what's required or not required, is on a local basis, what they require for you.
And for investors who are listening to this and saying, wow, I'd really like to go find someone who wants to start one of these homes, and I'd be willing to build the house and lease it out, how do you make that connection?
One of the easiest ways is to, well, you know, again, we do a live training, come to the class. There'll be people sitting right next to you saying, you buy the house, I'll run the business. We'll partner together in some format. But another way is to go to the people that operate in your location now, the ones that already have a residential assisted living home, approach them and say, hey, if you're looking to expand into another location, I'm a real estate investor. I'm willing to buy it, lease it to you. You tell me where you want it and let's work together. Now, some states have a lot of these homes, Florida, Arizona, thousands of these homes. Some states have very, very few. So finding that operator, that may be a trick in itself.
So now let's talk about those who want to actually own and operate the residential assisted senior living home. Obviously, that's different from just investing in the real estate and having someone else take it over. What are some of the considerations you need to have in order to start one of these homes?
And before I even answer that, I want to say I'm answering these questions in such a way that people, when they're listening, some of them are thinking, wow, that's a lot of work, or that's a challenge, or that's a roadblock. And you know what? I'm doing that purposely. I just want you all to know, because this is not for the faint of heart. It's not for somebody who's just looking to make quick money. It's for somebody who's looking to do something beyond that. And what I mean is, you'll make plenty of money. Our motto is do good and do well. The do good, though, is to help other people. The do well means you can crush it and make a ton of money. I've taught literally hundreds of thousands of people in five countries and all over the U.S. and so on. But most people are interested in cash flow. And a lot of times people look at a unit, whether it's single family or an apartment, and they calculate it on a per door basis, $100 per door in profit after all my expenses. So if I were to say how many doors or homes would you need to have to make $10,000 a month, which, by the way, is a number that out of hundreds of thousands of people that I've trained, it's a pretty magical number that most people say, yeah, I could squeeze by on 10 grand a month. So how many houses would you need? How many apartment buildings would you have to have? And when you add that up, it's like, well, I need 100 houses to do that, or 50 houses to do that, depending on the market you're in. And knowing that one tenant who blows up your house or apartment on the way out can cost you that month's profit. But so 100 homes versus what I do, which is one home that nets $10,000 a month after all expenses. So I just wanted to bring that out because it is definitely worth, the pearl is worth the dive, as they say, but you have to be willing to do what it takes. It's not just to buy it and hold it and rent it out to somebody else. So I wanted to throw that in there and make sure it's clear. And I forgot the question you asked me, Brian. So,
I'll get back to that. But you bring up a good point. I'm really glad you said that, because it is important to remember, you know, this isn't just an investment or if you start a business like this, it's not a passive business. You're dealing with real people.
Yeah.
And, you know, that's the primary purpose, is to help other people with this type of business. I will say, having looked into this space in the past, that I've noticed that there, you have the people who start this type of business because they want to help other people, and maybe they're doing it for personal reasons or helping someone within their family, and then they just kind of open it up to other individuals as well. But what a lot of those people lack is the business sense, the infrastructure to actually run it as a business. Because while it is important to remember, yes, you're dealing with people's lives and you have to take good care of them, it's also a business, and you have to know how to run it as a business. So I'm glad you brought that up. But my question was basically, what are some of the considerations for those who do want to start this type of business?
So the way I teach it is a three-legged stool. On the three legs, one of them is the business, one of them is the staff, and the third is the residents. So the people that get into this for all about the residents, I'm all about taking care of people and so on, but they don't have the business savvy and they're not, you know, hiring other people, they're doing it all themselves. It's a one-legged stool that's bound to collapse or be uncomfortable at best. So it can't just be all about the people. On the staffing part, hey, I don't like to have employees either. So as best I can, I treat everybody like a team member. We're on a team, we're doing something together, casting that vision and having them work within this. But there are people that this is what they do. Caregivers, managers of these homes, they can't be, they won't be a barista at Starbucks. They're not going to stuff bags at the grocery store, but they're willing to work for minimum wage plus a couple of dollars, and their heart is all about taking care of seniors. So those people, this is their job. This is their place to have their career. So the staff is kind of a necessary evil, but you have to have that. The business side, if you're not charging enough, you can't make enough to pay the staff. If you charge too much, you won't have enough residents who can afford. So you do need to understand the business basics. That's a lot of what we teach at the REL Academy, is not only the location of the real estate, not only what to do in the house and sprinklers and so on, but how to operate the business so you can attract the clients, so that you can get the team to be able to provide the service that's required and do this in a way that you can be highly profitable. The places where people, I'm going to go right to the mistakes that people make, because I think that's always a great way to go. Somebody may listen to this and say, got it. Get a house, fill it with seniors, get a babysitter, and I'm done. No, not quite. I even had somebody say, well, I could get a book out of the library or from Amazon on how to do this. Yeah, got it. But this is real humans that we're talking about. And anybody who's done anything before that is new for you, I'd much rather learn from your mistakes than mine. So the concept of the business and what it takes and how to run it, and there's some elements that are in every business, absolutely. But there's certain ones very specific to this industry. How do I find the residents? How do I get the caregivers? How do I take care of all of this? And then more importantly to me, how do I do this where it's hands off and I'm not sucked into this on a daily basis? Those are the key points. The mistakes that people make is thinking, oh, it's just a real estate play. Nope, that's one part. I can do this where I'm going to be living in the house and taking care of business day to day. Okay, you don't own the business then, it owns you. So there's mistakes that people make and how to attract residents, how to get the team, how to put it together, how to keep it together, that we teach them so that they're not doing a lot of things that just waste a lot of time. So the business is very important. The residents are very important. The staff, the team is very important. It's a three-legged stool.
And let's talk about the staff briefly. What are the requirements? How many staff people do you actually have to have?
The state requirement is you as the business owner determine how many caregivers you need to take care of your residents. It's that vague and that simple. Whether it's Brookdale with 200 beds or whether it's me with 10 beds, it's the same rule. So I gave a rule of thumb of 5-1, 6-1. Most states have no rule. You determine. That's why a large corporation can get away with having, you know, 10 caregivers for 200 people.
If you have 10 residents and you're doing a 6-1 or 5-1, then you would have two staff members there at all times. Is that kind of how it breaks down?
Well, we would typically have two caregivers there during the day. That might be 6:30 a.m. to 6:30 p.m. Then the night shift comes in and we do what's called a wake staff. So they're not just asleep in the home, but they're awake at night, taking care of residents if they need it, preparing food, cleaning the house, doing things at night for the next day's shift. So it is 24-hour care. We typically have two during the day, one at night. Some people do a live-in model where the caregivers stay overnight at the home and they sleep there. And then one of the staff members who are sleeping there gets up in the middle of the night to take care of residents. I don't do that model, but some people do, perfectly fine.
And what about the preparation of the food and shopping and groceries? How does all that work?
In most homes, the caregivers provide or take care of the food preparation and serving the food. They also take care of cleaning the house as well as taking care of the residents. So you can imagine that's a full-time and a hard job for those caregivers. In a nicer, more upscale home, like my nicest home, we have a chef, white jacket, white hat. They come in and prepare food from 6:30 a.m. to about 12:30 in the afternoon. They'll do cook-to-order breakfast, cook-to-order lunch. They'll prepare dinner in between that the caregivers serve later that night. So it depends on the staffing ratios and quality and how much basically you're charging and how much you can afford. The food itself, you can have food delivered to the house just like you can in your own home. Or in my case, the manager is the one who's responsible. So some food is delivered, but she'll also go out and shop for food and then bring it to the homes to make sure the homes are stocked.
So I know you touched on this briefly already, but I'd like to go over the numbers again and just kind of get a sense of the income and the expenses and how it all shakes out.
Yeah, and this is the fun part. You know, for all of us, you're listening to a real estate show, guys, and it's all about the real estate and the cash flow and the money. So I'm going to keep it high level, but I'm going to go through it again. The average in America today is $3,750 per person, per resident, per month. So if you have 10 residents, the potential gross income, $37,500 per month. Realistically, about 70% of that goes to expenses, meaning the caregivers, the manager, the mortgage payment or rent, whether you're renting the home or renting it from your own entity, separate entity, the food, insurance, everything, all those expenses, about 70%. So the bottom line, 30% of the gross income falls to the bottom line in profit. So that 30%, when somebody looks at that, it's kind of interesting because when we talk cap rates, which we love to do in real estate, somebody says, oh, if it's only a X cap, that's good or bad. Well, hang on. This is not a real estate play. The real estate might be a 10 cap, but the business itself, if you've got 30% falling to the bottom line, EBITDA, that's huge. 30%. Grocery stores are 3% and they're happy. One of the largest retailers, Kohl's, is now at 7%. They are ecstatic. To have 30% is enormous. Imagine getting 30% of your apartment rentals to the bottom line in net cash flow before taxes. That's a huge number. And the reason why it's huge, there's moving parts. It's a business that you're operating, not just the real estate.
And what are some of the startup costs?
Depends on the realist. Let's start with the acquisition of the house. So the acquisition of the house, everybody listening knows to buy a house may require a down payment. Not always. First house I did was no money down, and last house I did was no money down. So it may require a down payment. The renovations, it may or may not need significant renovations. Assume it needs anywhere from $5,000 to $200,000. $200,000, Gene, what's that? Hey, we've had students put on 2,000 square foot additions. We've had students convert garages into living space and so on and so on. So the answer on the renovation cost is it depends on what it is and what it is you want to get it to. The carrying cost, it's going to take you 2 months, 4 months on the low side to get from I own the building to I'm licensed and I'm up and running. I'm always going to tell people 6 to 12 months to get up and running. 6 to 12 months. So that means from the purchase of that real estate to the time where my doors are open, I've got residents moving in and I'm cash flowing, 6 months to 12 months. So you better be prepared for that negative cash flow during that time. So those are kind of the startup costs. It depends. Are you leasing or renting? One is faster than the other, of course. Are you buying an existing business that already has a license, already has residents, already has everything there? You're cash flowing day one. So it really does depend.
And that upfront investment, are you including the cost of furniture and you know, mattresses and couches and things like that?
Great point. You know, that's one of the things that people miss is it's a home. It's an empty house to start, but to make it a home, you need furniture. Forks, spoons, knives, toaster, blender, microwave, all of that. Plus a dining room table, family room furniture, TVs in the rooms. You're not going to necessarily furnish every bedroom because some people bring their own. But you do need that as well. Now, you can lease all that furniture, $500 a month, $20,000 worth of furnishings for the home, or you can purchase it. You can do it new. You can do it inexpensive. But that's a great point. The furnishings, if it's not there, you're going to have to get it or lease it.
So, Gene, do you have any success stories from either yourself or your students that you want to share?
Absolutely. Now, one of the things that I'm enjoying the most about teaching others how to do this is watching them get their homes up and running and how it's transformative for their lives. people. I just got back from Kansas City, and we did a one-day tour. Went to Kansas City for a grand opening of one of our students, a home in the middle of a beautiful neighborhood in the Kansas City area. And it's a home you wouldn't know that there is a residential assisted living business there now. But we drive up, open house. They had over 3 days, 150 people through the home. And again, it's just a home in a neighborhood. To see the renovations and to see the work they've done and all of this come to fruition, and it is just magical. So that home itself was the open house, the reason why we did the tour. But before that, drove out to another location, Manhattan, Kansas, and one of our students there had just opened their first home, a 13-bed facility in Kansas. And in this home, they built it from scratch. So they bought land in an area that was perfectly located. It's just, they did everything I suggest they do. They built this home, and the vision is not only that home, which is beautiful, they did a fantastic job, but they also have another building they're gonna put up, a 12-bed memory care facility. Then they're also putting up another building, and then another building that they'll lease out for medical and so on. So it was just a fantastic campus they're putting together on their 10 or 12 acres. But the home itself felt like a home, and yet the license for 13, they've just done a fantastic job. They opened, I'm going to say, the beginning of the month. We were about the third week into the month. They have three residents in there already. And that is fantastic. That's exactly what we show people how to do, how to get up and running quickly and fill your home. So they'll be full in no time. And they're charging $6,900 per person per month. So they're already bringing in $18,000-$19,000 in gross income. They're well on their way to being extremely profitable in that one home. It was great.
Say that again. How much are they charging per person per month?
$6,900 per person per month. And they've got their first three residents in. And it's a beautiful facility. Again, I said the average is $3,750, but there's people spending. It's very interesting when I'm in front of a live audience and I have people raise their hand, who here knows of somebody in assisted living and do you know what it costs? And then they give the numbers. It's $4,000, $6,000, $8,000, $10,000 a month. And everybody else is like, I had no idea. And how do you pay for that? You take care of mom. You love her. You pay whatever it is. You take care of them. You put them in a beautiful place. So $6,900 a month times three, that's $20,000 right there. And those are the first three residents. They're well on their way to being hugely profitable in that one business.
And that brings up a number of questions. But one of the questions that comes to mind is, how do the actual residents afford this? I mean, if they're paying $3,700 to $8,000 a month, where is this money coming from?
We don't focus on Medicare and Medicaid. So let's just start with that. That right now, if a senior is, they don't have income, don't have assets, you can go to the state. The feds give money to the state. The state will create a program, prove to us you have no income, no assets, and we will pay up to, usually it's about $2,000 a month to take care of somebody in assisted living. We don't focus on that for obvious reasons. I can't run a great business in a great home with great food and great caregivers if all I'm getting is $2,000 per person. So what we focus on is the private pay. This is the person that does have some assets. Think about the average 80-year-old today. They probably worked for a company for 30 or 40 years. They retired. They've got a pension. They've got Social Security. They've got a house that they paid $10,000 for, and it's worth $310,000, and they own it free and clear. So they've got equity in the home. So they've got all of that going for them, and that is what is then used to pay for their care at their end of life. So once that money runs out, now it's the kids. And again, somebody who's 85 probably has 4, 5, 6 kids. They had bigger families back then. So now the kids gather around and they start to supplement and pay for mom or dad's care. So that's how the typical family does it. Less than 10% of all of the people out there have what's called long-term care insurance. That's a private policy, optional, costs $2,000 to $5,000 a year in a premium. Very few people have that. But when somebody does come into our assisted living home and they have a long-term care policy, that's a beautiful thing because that usually pays $200-$300 a day towards their care, which we can charge the insurance company anything we want. So we will typically charge them the maximum allowable amount for sure. So very few people have long-term care insurance. A lot of people have no plan. They have no clue. They're going to go to Social Security and Medicare, Medicaid, the state program. What we do is we focus on private pay, those people in between that do have families that love them, we'll take care of them, and we'll pay to take care of them.
As we wrap it up, any further thoughts for our listeners about this topic?
Yeah. You know, I want to make sure everybody hears what I'm about to say. You're all going to get involved in assisted living one way or the other. What I mean by that is you're either going to own the real estate or operate the business or both, or you or a family member is going to be in assisted living, lying in the bed, writing a check to somebody else to take care of. So if nothing else, for you, for your family, for the future generations, so that all of your hard work doesn't go away in the last 2-3 years of your life paying for assisted living, get one of these homes. Even one of these homes netting you $5,000, $10,000, $15,000, $20,000 a month in profit today. Hey, if you don't need the money, give it away. Lots of people would love to accept it. But now you've got a place to move into the master bedroom when you or a parent need it. Because if you don't, you're going to be writing that check for $5,000 or $6,000 a month to take care of mom or dad or grandma or grandpa or a spouse. But if you own the home, move into the master bedroom, live for free, pass that cash flowing asset onto your kids so they have future income.
Gene, I really want to thank you for taking the time to share this information with us on residential assisted living. It's really a fascinating topic, and it's going to become more and more important as time goes on and people age into that population. So thank you so much for taking the time to share it with us, and we appreciate you being here.
Thank you, and I appreciate you very much.
Hey, everybody. Thanks for listening to this episode with Gene Guarino on senior assisted living housing. I want to remind all of you that Gene is going to be one of our featured speakers at the Michigan Landlord and Real Estate Investor Free Conference and Expo of 2019. It's happening February 21st through 23rd right here in Grand Rapids, Michigan. And you can go to rpoaonline.org to register for free. You're not going to want to miss this. We have a lot of great speakers, a lot of great panel sessions, and you're also going to be doing some fantastic networking. Hope you can make it. rpoaonline.org. Register for free. This episode was sponsored by Green Property Management, managing everything from single-family homes to apartment complexes in the West Michigan area. Find out more at greenpropertymgt.com. And RCB and Associates, helping real estate investors and small business owners navigate the complex world of health insurance and Medicare benefits at rcbassociatesllc.com.
You've been listening to the Rental Property Owner and Real Estate Investor Podcast, brought to you by the Rental Property Owner Association. You can find out more at rpoaonline.org. If you enjoyed this podcast, please go to iTunes to subscribe, rate, and review.